Hello everyone, this is Pavani Neelakantham from Telangana Social Welfare Residential Armed Force Preparatory Degree College for Women. It is located in Bongir and this is the only college in India which provides army training to girls students. So today we are going to discuss about control structures in C++. What are these control structures? Control structures, as the name says, they are used to alter the flow of execution of program. Now first I'll explain you in simple words. Normally, say suppose you want to go to your uncle's house. How do you go? You just step out of the house and then do you go straight and all? In that way, do you think you'll reach your uncle's house? No, unless it is in front of your house, right? So what do? We have the roadmap of the destination in our mind. And once we move out of our house and whenever we come across a junction, we decide there, in our mind will decide there whether I have to go left or you have to go right. Your mind will decide that and based on that decision, you will move along your path. Yes or no? Then only you will be able to reach your destination. So in the same way, in our programming also, normally by default, the program flow will be sequential. That is, the program statements will be executed one line after the other in a sequential manner, the way it is written in the program. But that will not be enough for us in order to implement many of the logics. So we definitely need an alter in the flow of the program. The flow of execution of the program needs to be altered in order to implement our logic. So for that only we need our control structures. Understood now? So now these control structures are divided into three categories. One is selection statements, the second one is repetitive statements, and the third one is unconditional branching statements. We'll see one after the other what each of it means. Selection, as the name says, selection or decision statements will help us identify some option based on some condition. Again, under the selection category, we have if statement, if else statement, and switch statement. What are these? First, we'll discuss about if statement. If statement is nothing but, say suppose we'll take an example again. If, that is, now just see the syntax also of that if statement. If, and then the condition, and then followed by the statements. Can you see that? If, and the condition, and then followed by the statement. If the condition is true, then only the statements will be executed. Okay, so just let's take an example. Say suppose you have some occasion nearby, maybe it's your birthday or some cousin's marriage and all. We sometimes decide, right? You people might be deciding, we all do that. We sometimes decide that I want a yellow colored dress for this particular occasion. Yes or no? It's a decision that we have taken. Then you'll go to a mall. There you'll ask him, come on, please show me some yellow colored dresses of so and so type. Okay, if he is showing us an yellow colored dress, then of that you will choose your statement or of that you will choose your dress. Else what will you do? You will ignore that and you will ignore that shop totally and come out for another shop. Yes or no? We are a bit stubborn sometimes, right? We do that. So if is also the same. What will if do? Only if the condition is true, that statements will be executed. Else it will totally ignore the statements. Okay, so now we'll just see one simple example for if. You all know positive number, right? A positive number is a number which is greater than 0. Now, shall we write the code in if? A code snippet I'll be writing, which means that a part of code I'll be writing in if, which will check for positive number. So just see how do we write it? Just note everything that we are writing, ma. If, say suppose I want to check for the positive number, right? I want to check if num is greater than 0. Num is greater than 0, then I want to display that it is positive. So assume that the variable that I am using is num. So if num greater than 0. Now this is the condition. We said no, if the condition is true, the statements will be executed is what we said. So this num greater than 0 is the condition. Did I put a semicolon there? No. In syntax also you should see, after if we never use semicolon. Okay, remember that. Then this flower brackets indicate the body of the if. So inside body what should I write? Cout positive number. Yes or no? So is it what we want now? I'm saying if the condition is true, then display positive number. Example, say suppose the num value of num is 5. What should it do? It will come here. Num greater than 0. Yes, 5 is greater than 0. Gets inside. Output will be positive number. Take one more example. Say suppose I've given the value of num as minus 2. Come here. Minus 2 greater than 0? No, false. So what will happen? The control will directly jump outside my if. Followed or not? This indicates the body of if, no? So outside the if. Just the same way for a non-LO dress you rejected the shop, no? So in the same way, this will also reject that if and it will come outside the if statement. So understood what is simple if? This is also called as a simple if statement. Then the second one is if else statement. Just have a look in the flowchart also, ma. Just have a look at the flowchart. How is that? If else statement is the statement where the condition will have a dual path. Dual means two-way path. That is, if the condition is true, one set of statements will be executed. Else, if the condition is false, one more set of statements will be executed. That is the way your if-else statement works. So, I'll have a if and then else. Coming back to our previous example, we talked about your uncle's house, right? Say, suppose your uncle lives in the same locality. You'll have it in your mind. If I go left, I'll reach my uncle's house. Else, I'll go to my own house by just going straight. Yes or no? So, what are we doing? We are just deciding whether I have to go to left or go straight. In the same way, in the set of statements also to be executed will be decided based on the condition being checked. And one more thing you have to remember, can you go to your uncle's house and your own house at the same time? No. In the same way, in if else also, only one part of the block will be executed at a time, not both together. Okay. So coming back to your example, we'll see our positive number example. Yes. So if number is greater than 0, then I'm saying positive number. Else, that is, if this condition is false, can I say else here and then see out negative number? Agree with me, all of you? What am I doing? I'm checking if number is greater than 0. If number is greater than 0, then I'm displaying that it is positive number. Else, if the condition is false, then what do I want to be displayed? I want to display negative number. Agree with me, everyone? Say, suppose, take an example again. Say, suppose again, number value is 8. If the number value is 8, what should I do? Come here. 8 greater than 0? Yes, 8 is greater than 0. Come inside, it will display positive number. Then do you think again it will come to else? No, it will jump out of the if else structure. Followed or not? Now say suppose the next input, say suppose I'm giving minus 5 as num value. Now say minus 5 greater than 0, no, false. So what should it do? It should not come here. It will directly comes to else part and then it will display negative number, minus 5, so negative number. And then once this is done, it will jump out of the loop and the execution of if else will be done. Followed or not, my everybody? So if else is a dual path statement. Now you might be getting a doubt. Why only positive number and negative number? The number can be zero as well, right? So for that reason, we need else if statement. That is, if I want one more condition to be specified, go back to our previous example. Left, if I go left, I'll reach my uncle's house. If you go straight, I'll reach my own house. Or if you go right, I'll reach my aunt's house. So what is happening? I have one more condition to be checked. You should think it that way. Okay, if you go left, you'll reach your uncle's house. Straight, you reach your own house. And right, you'll go your aunt's house. So I have to specify one more condition there. So in the similar way, if you have dual path statements and if you want to add one more condition, you need to give else if statement. So we'll just come back to our example. As I've told you before, positive number, negative number, and I want to attach 0 as well. So we'll just write this code. Here we'll say number greater than 0. I'll say see out positive. And then tell me what is the next condition. number less than 0, right? I'll put it here, and before in else was empty, right? But here I want one more condition to be checked. So else if, remember ma, there is a gap between them. Else if, and then here I'll write my condition num less than 0. Agree? Then I'll put c out negative number, and then else. Here again I need not check. If it is not positive, not negative, definitely it will be 0. So here I'll display 0. Everyone understood? Is it clear? So what did we do? And one more thing you have to note. See here, for the first if, I gave brackets, curly braces, opening and closing. That is the body of the if statement. Okay. For the second, I ignored these braces. Nothing wrong. It will not give me any syntax error because I have only one statement. If in body of any control statement, if we have only one line of code, then we can ignore the curly braces. For that only, I gave it this way. So if num greater than 0, positive. Num less than, else if num less than 0, negative. Else, see out 0. Again, come up with our example. Say suppose num value is minus 2. Come here. Minus 2 greater than 0? No. Come to else if. Minus 2 less than 0? Yes. Displays negative and comes out of if. Followed or not, everybody? So this is the way our if statement works. If, else and else if. And else if, I can have many number of else ifs also. I can have different levels of else ifs based on our requirement. Then coming to the third one, which is the switch statement. Switch statement. Actually, we thought, no, if we have more number of conditions, we can go for if, else if and all. But else if becomes complicated. If I add more levels of else if statements, it becomes too complicated and it becomes confusing for the programmer. So what do? We use switch statement in that case. Switch statement is a multi-way or multi-path statement. Just have a look at the syntax of switch statement. In switch, we write switch in bracket the value or expression whose value I want to check. Okay, and inside we are writing case. Case is a keyword there. Case, and beside that we are writing constant 1. Then case constant 2, case constant 3 and so on. Here these constants are the ones through to which my value will be compared with. Following or not? We wrote no in switch value of variable or value we wrote no. That value will be compared with each of these case constants, and based on that the steps will be taken, or based on that the execution will happen. If you see the example, you'll understand it better. So just see our switch case example. Just see it, have a look at it properly. Switch of day, just this program, now this code snippet is to display, is to take input as a numeric number, okay, of the day, and to display the name of the week. That is what is my code snippet about. Okay, so my code snippet, in my code snippet what I do is, here this day is the variable that I'm talking about. This day value will be compared with these constants. I told you, case is a, what is case? Case is the keyword I said. And then 0, 1, whatever we have here, these are the 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are the case constants. So I want to display, if the user is entering 0, I want to display Sunday. If the user enters 1, I want to display Monday. User enters 2, Tuesday, and so on. This is the way I want my program to work. So how did we write? Just see, switch, and then the day, that is what the user entered, and then inside that case constant 0, and then see out Sunday, and we wrote break statement. I'll tell you at the end what this break statement means. Okay, then we wrote case 1 Monday, case 2 Tuesday, and so on. Now just take an input and then try. Say suppose the user has entered the day as 2. Okay, then see what happens. Day is compared with case constant 0, not matching. Then it comes to 1, not matching. Then it comes to 2. Yes, match is found. Then what will it do? It will display Tuesday, and then break will bring it outside the if switch statement. It will come over here. Following or not? So it will bring the control statement, or say it will bring the control flow directly outside the switch statement. That is the use of break there. Break will terminate the switch statement at that time, because day can be only one at a time. That's the reason. Now say, suppose again take one more example. Say the day is given as 4. Okay, so again it will compare the day with 0, not matching, 1, not matching, 2, not matching, 3, not matching, 4, it is matching for case constant 4, and then it displays Thursday here. And once after displaying Thursday, once it finds grip break, it will come, the control will come outside the switch statement. Following or not, how our switch works? Now you should understand why we have given break there. If we don't give break there, what happens is it will display all the cases, all the cases until it encounters a break. Now say, for example, I have given 2. Now day is 2. Assume that we have removed all the breaks there. Assume that in the program or in that code snippet, we have removed all the breaks and I have given the day value as 2. Then what happens? It will match with 0, not matching, 1, not matching, 2, matching. It will display Tuesday, and also it will following, it will be displaying all Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday as well. That is the reason we give break. Once a match is found, I want, the work is done. Now I want to come out of the switch statement. That is what break is used for. And one more, if you notice in our syntax, we have given default case. What is default case? Default case is the case which will be executed when the constant or say the day value is not matching with any of these. Then the default case will be executed. Following or not? Now say, suppose our days, we have given it as 0 to 6, right? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 means Saturday, 0 means Sunday. That way we have given. What if the user gives 8 there? I can't simply stop my program there, no? So what should I do? I should give him a proper error statement or something. So if the user enters 8 there and it is not matching with any of the case constants 0 to 6, then I want to display wrong input. For that reason, we have this default case in switch statement. So, till now we have discussed about selection statements. Now we are going to discuss the second category of control statements, which are iteration or repetitive statements. What are these iteration repetitive statements? They are also called as loops. Repetition, as the name says, it is used to repeat some code again and again until some condition is met. Say, suppose, take for example, your class consists of some 60 students, okay, and you want to display some message, or say you want to display roll number 1 is, roll number 2 is, or say you want to display marks of roll numbers and marks and roll numbers of students of 60 students. Why only 60? Sometimes you display all the students of the college as well, right? 400, 500 also. In such a case, do you think we'll write so many cout statements? No. If that is the case, there is no use of programming at all. But we use repetitive statements. These repetitive statements will allow us to repeat or display or do something with the code again and again until some condition is met or until a count is reached. Following or not? So these repetitive statements are under two categories. One is pre-test and post-test loops. What is this pre-test? Pre means before, right? And what is that test? Test is nothing but the condition that I was talking about. So in pre-test loops, first the condition will be checked and then the statements will be executed. Can you see it in the flowchart? In pre-test loops, first the condition will be checked. If the condition is true, then only the set of statements will be executed. Else, if the condition is false, it totally comes out of the loop. It will not attempt the execution at all. That is about pre-test. And in post-test, first the statements will be executed and then the condition will be checked. Following or not? Here first the statements will be executed and then the condition is checked. Only if the condition is true, now it moves up and then it executes the statements repeatedly. If the condition is false, it comes out of the loop. So what do you notice in both of them? Here the statements are executed only if the condition is true. If the condition is false, your statements will not be executed at all. Yes or no? But whereas in post-test loop, keeping aside the condition, the statements are executed at least once. Once the statements will be executed and then only the condition will be checked. And repetition happens again based on the condition. Following or not? You'll better understand it while we are seeing the loops now. Under repetition statements, we have three loops. One is for loop, the other one is while loop, and the third one is do while loop. We'll see one after the other how they perform. Now first one, for loop. What is this for loop? For loop consists of three parts. We have to remember that for loop consists of three parts. First is the initialization part, second condition checking, and the third one is the updation part. What do you mean by initialization? Initial means giving the first value. This is the initialization part. Okay, so once I give the initial value, that initial value will be the one with which I start. Okay, the second one will be condition checking. Condition checking will specify until when the loop will execute and when it should stop. And the third one is the updation part. Updation part means how much should I, whether should I change, to what extent should I change the counter value. And remember, for this for loop and all, we need a counter, right? Whenever I'm using any loop and whenever I'm repeating something, now say your previous example, students, 60 students if I'm displaying, I need a counter, no? Student number 1, student number 2, student number 3, then only I'll have a count of when I've started, when I'm going to end and all. So in the same way, for repetitive statements also, we need a counter. And that counter will be using wherever required. So here, in initialization, we need to initialize the counter. Initializing means giving it the first value. Okay, now first I'll just try to explain it with an example. Say suppose I'm trying to display 5 numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 natural numbers, first 5 natural numbers I'm trying to display. Where am I starting from? I want to start from 1, I want to display 2, 3, 4 and 5. Now you should decide how we are going to do it. Now say suppose, where am I going to start from? We'll start writing our for. Okay, for. Where should I start from? I want the first value to be 1. I'll take the counter as I. Okay, so I'll display it as I equal to 1. Because I want to start from 1, I have to initialize it to 1. I equal to 1. Then, just notice in the syntax also, all the three parts of for loop are separated with a semicolon. You have to, this is a must. If we forget it, we'll get a syntax error. So for I equal to 1, semicolon. Now I have to write the condition. What is the condition? Where should I stop is the condition. Where should I stop? I should stop at 5. Yes or no? So I'll write the condition as I less than or equal to 5. Agree with me? All the state numbers that I have in my output are all less than or equal to 5. That's the reason we have to write it this way. I less than or equal to 5. Then think, what is the updation? Updation, just see, first number is 1, second number is 2, 3, 4 and 5. So each of the next number is plus 1 of the previous one. Agree with me? I 1 and then I plus 1, 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 1, 3 and so on. Yes or no? So can I use increment operator? I'll write I plus plus. We all know that I plus plus is nothing but I equal to I plus 1. Yes or no? I plus plus, increment operator is nothing but I equal to I plus 1. So I is getting incremented by 1. And now I'll write the code. As I've told you, just like if the body of for will be within this curly braces. And then I'll write C out I. And I'll put endl. We all know endl is for new line, right? So now we'll rub this and we'll see what our actual output will be. I'll close this also. Now, shall we just trace our program or trace our snippet and see how our output will be? See here. Here I'll write the output. See now, first start with initialization. Initialization happens only once. Initialization happens only once, and that in the first iteration only. So first, I equal to 1, yes. Check the condition, 1 less than or equal to 5, true. Yes or no, the condition is true, 1 is less than 5. Then it gets inside. C out I means display I, 1. And then endl means it moves to the next line. Then here, from here, it goes to the updation part. We have to remember that. Okay, from here it goes to the updation part. I plus plus, that is I is incremented by 1. So before it was 1, no? Now how much will it become? It will become 2. Yes or no? So now 2. 2 less than 5? Yes, condition true. Get inside, C out I. So display 2. Then again go to updation. I becomes 3. 3 less than 5? Yes, it is true. Get inside, display 3. Then again, move to the updation, I becomes 4. 4 less than 5? Yes, true. Display 4, and then it is displayed. Then I becomes 5. 5 less than or equal to 5? Yes, matching. Then comes inside, display 5, and then displayed. And then I becomes 6. 6 less than or equal to 5? No, false. Then it comes out of the loop. Followed or not how our for is working? So this is the way we write our for loop. If you want, just have a look at our flow chart also in the slide. How we show that? We see here, first we have given I equal to 1. See here, first time I equal to 1, only once it happens. Then I am checking the condition. I am executing the body of the loop if it is true. And then I am going for updation part. And then again we are going to condition checking. And in the condition checking, if it is going wrong, if it is false, then we are coming out of the loop. So this is the way our for works. So after discussing about for, we'll see another repetition statement, that is while. While is another repetition statement in which we have only one part, that is condition checking. Just see the syntax of while, ma. While, condition, and then in brackets, I write the statements. Only if the condition is true, the statements will be executed. Else, the statements will not be executed. This condition, if the condition is true, then only the statements will be executed. If the condition is false, it comes out of the loop. It will not execute anything. Now, we'll try to write one more example. Before we have written, we have tried to display first 5 natural numbers in a sequence order 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, we'll try to display it in the reverse order. What is the reverse order? I want to display 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Shall we do that? Okay. One thing you have to remember with that while loop is, while loop has only condition checking. So, it is our responsibility as a programmer to do the initialization and the updation ourselves. We have to keep that in track. Okay. So, just now see how we write that while. Okay. While. Here, I'll write the condition. Okay, so before that, we want to display 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Where am I starting from? I'm starting from 5, right? In our previous case, we were starting from 1. So, we said initialized I to 1. But here, where am I starting from? I'm starting from 5. So, I need to initialize I equal to 5 before my loop itself. Understood, my everyone? So, I've initialized I equal to 5. Now, I should write the condition. What is the condition? What is that I want to display? I want to display 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I want to stop at 1. So, I should display all the numbers until they are greater than 1. So, can I write I greater than or equal to 1? Yes or no? Just think a bit. You need to think a bit once we are doing these control statements. Just think a bit. I'm starting from 5 and I want to stop at 1. So, I have to write it as greater than or equal to 1. In our previous case, for, we were starting at 1 and we were stopping at 5. So, we wrote I less than or equal to 5 there. Okay. Just go through it once more. Then, what is that I want to do? I want to display, right? Again, C out I and then endl. Okay. Now, where is our updation? In for, we had everything in one part. That was fine. But now, the basic mistake that we as a beginners, as programmers will do is, they forget the updation. We have to put that updation. What is that now? Just think once. Before it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So, incremented by 1. The updation part was just incrementing the I value by 1. But now, it is going down. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So, I have to, good, decrement by 1. So, it is I minus minus. Think and then close it. Did we get? I have initialized it. I'm specifying the condition and then I'm doing the updation part as well. Okay. Now shall we trace the program and see how it is going to work? Now start with it. I equal to 5. Okay. Then it is checking 5 greater than or equal to 1. Yes, it is greater than 1. Get inside, C out I. So 5 will be displayed. Then I minus minus. What will 5 become? 5 becomes 4. Again, come for the condition checking. 4 greater than or equal to 1? Yes, it is. Then display 4. Then, 4 I becomes 3 greater than or equal to 1? Yes. Get inside and then display 3. Okay, then again minus minus, I becomes 2. 2 greater than or equal to 1? Yes. Get inside, display 2. Then again I minus minus, it becomes 1. 1 equal to 1, right? Get inside, display 1. And then again I becomes minus minus, it becomes 0. 0 greater than or equal to 1? No, false. It comes out of the loop. Understood how while is working now? Okay, so this is the way while works. One thing we have to remember in while is you shouldn't forget the initialization or updation part. Now I'll just give you a hint. What if I forget the updation? As a beginner, we always do. Many of them do this mistake, nothing wrong. I'll just tell you what happens. We'll just see what happens if I miss that I++. See, I is 5. 5 greater than or equal to 1? Yes, it will display 5. Again, 5 greater than or equal to 1? It will display 5. Again, 5 greater than or equal to 1? It will display 5. And so on, all 5s will be printed in your screen. 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, 5, and your screen goes on scrolling. This happens for everyone and this is called as infinite loop. Infinite loop occurs when the updation of the counter variable does not happen properly. Okay, so that is that we have to take care when we are doing our while loop. The next loop that we are going to discuss is do while loop. In do while, this is a post-test loop. Till now we have seen while and then we have seen for. Both of them were pre-test loop. Remember or not, we were first checking the condition and then only the statements were being executed. If the condition was false in the first case, it will not execute the statements at all. For example, in while, if the initialization is some 0, it will not enter the loop at all. Okay, but whereas in do while, it is a post-test loop, implies the test happens at the end. Just look at the syntax of do while, ma. See here, it is do and no condition here. Are you noting that? There is no condition after do. Do is empty. Okay, and then I have my block of statements here appearing and then at the end I have the condition, while and then condition. And remember, this semicolon is a must for do while. Okay, this is the way it is recognized. And no other place for or if or while, in no other control statement we use this semicolon. Switch also we don't use. Only in do while we use this semicolon. You have to remember that. So, how will do while work? First, it will execute this set of statements, whatever is the value. And then it will check for the condition. Now, let us see an example for this do while as well. Okay. So, shall we write a program or a code snippet which displays odd numbers from 1 to 10? Yes. Tell me what are they? Shall I say, we'll write a code snippet to display 1, 3, 5, 7 and 9. Just think, I want to display 1, 3, 5, 7 and 9. Till now we only saw increment and decrement. The reason I am giving you different logics is that you should be able to write it again. Okay, so here again in do while, the initialization and updation should be taken care by you. So just see here, where am I starting from? Again, I'll take the looping counter as I. Okay, where am I starting from? I want to display 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. Just note and start thinking, everyone. You also start thinking, please. So, where should I start from? I is 1, right? So, I'm going to, my first element to be displayed is 1. So, I'll, without any doubt, initialize my I to 1. Okay? And then, my syntax of do while. First, it should start with do, yes or no? Do and nothing else. Just do that. That's it. It is not telling you any condition. It is not restricting you anywhere. It is saying, okay, ek bar, you just do it once, nothing wrong. Okay. And say, in do, I'm going to display, right? So, C out, and then I'll say I, and then put an end in. Okay. Fine. Displaying is over. Initialization is over. Now, updation part, just tell me, just think a bit, what would be updation? What are the values that we are displaying? I'm displaying 1, I'm displaying 3, I'm displaying 5, 7, 9. What is the increment there? Is it by 1? No, it is by 2, right? So, can I write it as I equal to I plus 2? Agree with me, everyone? So, this is the way we do the updation. And then, what will be the condition now? while, here I have to put the condition now in do while. While, what is the condition? Where should I stop? I should stop it before 10, right? So, shall I write the condition as I less than 10 and then put a semicolon? Don't forget the semicolon. I less than 10, I'm going to display all values until I reach 10. Now, just start tracing the program. Well, shall we trace the program and see? I'm writing output here. Okay, so first, starting from I is 1. I is 1, do get inside, display 1. It is not checking any condition, it directly is displaying 1. Okay, then I equal to I plus 2. 1 plus 2, it becomes 3. Yes or no? And then it is saying 3 less than 10. Yes, true. It comes inside, it displays 3. Okay, then I equal to I plus 2. 3 plus 2, 5. Then here it checks. 5 less than 10. Yes, true. It just goes again, displays 5. Again, 5 equal to 5 plus 2. 7. 7 less than 10. Yes, it goes above again, displays 7. Then 7 equal to 7 plus 2. 9. 9 less than 10. Yes, it goes again up and displays 9. Then again, 9 equal to 9 plus 2. 11. Come here, check. 11 less than 10, no, come out of the loop. Did I get the output that I want? 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, this is what we wanted, yes or no? So, this is the way we write our looping statements. Okay, so we discussed about for loop, while loop and do while loop. The next third branch of our statements, our control statements is unconditional branching statement. As the name says, unconditional branching implies we don't check the condition here. Under that, the first one is the return statement. What is this return statement? Return statement is used in functions. Okay, why is that used? I'll have a calling function, my main or any other function can be my calling function. And from there, if I have called, suppose some function add, and I want to give the control flow back to my main, then in such a case, we say it is return. We use return statement. Just the way we return back something to others, no? If it is theirs, I'll return it back. No? In the same way, the control flow will be returned back to the calling function. So, that is the way your return statement is used. The second unconditional branching statement is break. Have you seen break any time before? We have seen it, right? Where? In switch case. Okay. So, what did that break do there? We said that break is used to terminate the switch statement. Terminate, that is stop it there and come out of that. Break has the same functionality in all the loops as well. I can use break to terminate my loop or terminate my switch statement. Terminate means break it there, come out on there. Okay, that is what is your break means. Then continue statement. Continue statement is used when I want to terminate only the current iteration of the loop. All the other iterations will go as it is, but only the current iteration, that is the statements below the continue, will be skipped and then it goes to the updation part of the loop. Okay, that is what your continue statement is. Break will totally terminate the loop, whereas continue will only terminate the current iteration of the loop and goes to the updation. And the fourth category here is go to statement. What is go to? Just go there. We say no, without any condition, without any reason, if I just tell you go there, then that is the way your go to also works. Go to is an unconditional branching statement where it will just send the control flow to another part of the program. Just see how we write it is. We write it as go to and then label name. Okay, whatever is the label name that I am specifying, wherever that label name occurs in the program, there the control will go. If it is before go to, we call it as a backward jump. And if the label name occurs after go to, we call it as a forward jump. So that way your go to statement works. And go to statement actually, ma, it is unconditional branching. And actually it is not a good programmer's practice to use this go to statement, because break, continue and return have their own purposes again. Yes or no? They are needed in switch case, or they are needed in some other parts of the program. Okay, but whereas go to is not a good programmer practice. We can avoid go to. If you want to be a good programmer, we can avoid go to and write our logic properly. Okay, that is about your unconditional branching statements. So, what did we discuss about today? We discussed about control statements, and under control statements we saw three categories. What are they? Selection statement. Under selection statements we talked about if statement, if else statement, we talked about else if ladder, and then we also talked about switch case statement. Then under repetitive statements we talked about for loop, while loop and do while loop. Then remember, your for and while fall under pretext loop categories. Yes or no? They both are pretest loops, whereas your do while is post test loop. It will do the testing condition later, after the executing the programs or executing the statements at least once. That's the reason we say in post test loop, that is in do while, it is a question asked in many of the competitive exams, which is a post test loop, and it means that you have to write that it is do while loop. And what does that mean? It means that it executes the set of statements at least once. Whatever is the condition, it will execute the set of statements at least once. Okay. Then we talked about unconditional branching statements. In unconditional branching statements, we talked about return statement. Return statements, which means that it will return the control flow back to the calling function. Okay. And then we talked about break statement, which will terminate the loop, which will perfectly terminate the loop or terminate the switch. Terminate means come out of it, bluntly come out of it. Okay. Then we talked about continue statement. Continue, which means that which will terminate only the current iteration of the loop. Okay. And then it goes to the updation part again. Only the current iteration will be terminated. And then we talked about go to, which is unconditional branching, which may take a forward or a backward jump. Now we'll see our assignment. Just see this assignment, ma. I am just saying that you have to write a program to display multiplication table. Always remember, everyone, whenever we are given any logic or any program to be executed, we have to first decide which control statement I need. Following or not? I have to first decide which control statement I need, and then I also should decide what would be the initialization, what would be the condition. If I am taking a loop, I have to think about what would be the initialization, what would be my updation, and what would be my updation part, and then the condition checking part. All that should be pre-decided. It is always the habit of a good programmer is that whenever you get any program for execution, you first need to put it on paper. Then only start typing the program. Don't directly sit and type the program. Okay, first put it on paper. Think what the logic should be. What are the control statements that are needed? And then only start writing. Now see, just we'll discuss briefly about our assignments. Assignment problems, the first one is multiplication table. What is this multiplication table? Multiplication table is nothing but the tables that we have learned in our primary classes, right? 5 ones are 5, 5 twos are 10, 5 threes are 15, and so on till 5 tens are 50. In that way, I want to write a code which will display the multiplication table of any number that is given to me. Following or not? For that, I want to write a program. How will you write it? Just think. I want to display for any number that is given. I want 5 ones are 5 into 1 into 2 into 3 and so on into 10. Till there, I want to display. So I should take I as my counter, and counter value should be initialized to 1. Following or not? Counter value should be initialized to 1, and then it should be incremented by 1, because first 1, second 2 and so on. And then where should it stop? It should stop at 5 tens are 50. So my condition should be I less than or equal to 10. And inside that, what would be my body of loop? Body of loop would be C out num into I. Whatever is the number that user has given, that into I. So what happens in the first iteration? Say suppose the number given is 4. In the first iteration, 4 into 1, it will display 4. In the second iteration, 4 into 2, it will display 8. 4 into 3, it will display 12, and so on, 4 tens are 40. Did we get the multiplication table? So this is the way whenever any work is given to you, any program is given to you, and later on once you become software engineers, you'll get projects to you. So once you get it, you have to first decide how to implement this logic. Which is the best control structure? And actually in loops also, ma, we have to decide which is the best one. Now say in our multiplication example, for loop is better because I have initialization, I have updation in that. So that is the reason for loop is better. In cases where there are some cases where while loop would be better. Say suppose where I have only condition and the updation happens by itself. My code itself includes the updation. In such cases, I can prefer while loop. And do while loop, where do we need? Imagine, do you all know menu programs, right? Say suppose I'll give you a program wherein a menu needs to be displayed. And in that menu, you'll choose some options. Say suppose I'm writing a program for arithmetic operations. In that arithmetic operations, I want to give a choice to the user. I'll take two numbers as input, just like your calculator, the calculator program. So in that, what do we want? First, we should allow the user to enter any two numbers and perform any operation. So one time execution should be free without any condition. Next time, if he wishes, he can continue. Else, my program will come out. So in such cases, your do while loop will be the best. Following or not? So this is the way, based on the program given, you have to identify. The second one, see, what is the program, what is the assignment that is given? Program to display the name of the month. We have already done the name of the day, right? We have done it. Which control statement did we use there? Switch, right? So using switch, I displayed the name of the day there. So similarly, you can write there, we had seven cases, right? Here you'll have 12 cases. Using 12 cases, you can display the name of the month. That's it. The second program needs switch control statement. What is the third one? To display the grade of the student based on percentage. We all have our CBCS, right? We are all, nowadays you're all getting grades based on the percentage. So for that, I need to check the percentage. In which category it falls, based on that I'll display the grade. For this, the best control statement would be a else if ladder. First I'll check if grade greater than or equal to 85, or say if percentage greater than or equal to 85, I'll display grade outstanding. Else if grade percentage greater than or equal to 75, I'll display A grade. Else if, so here I'm going on checking different conditions, yes or no? So that is the reason your else if statements are better to be used in such conditions. Okay, following or not? So we discussed about control statements, and then we discussed how they are useful in our lives. So not to become good programmers, you have to get a perfect grip on these control statements. Once you have a good grip on the control statements, you can learn any language very easily. Extra, whatever are the extra things that are there in that language, if you learn, that is enough. But if you have a good grip on this, learning any new programming language would be very easy for you. So just do all the assignments, do more and more programs on these control statements, and then get a good grip on that. All the best, everyone. You can also just go through all the nested if statements. Nested if means if inside an if statement. If we have an if statement inside another if statement, then we call it as a nested if statement. In the same way, we can have nested loops also. So just go through all that. Hope we meet again. All the best, everyone, and take care. Thank you.